Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents American Heritage History of the American Revolution by Bruce Lancaster. Read by Paul Boehmer. Introduction. Bruce Catton. We had our American Revolution nearly 2 centuries ago, and the years have done something to it. The legends remain, and the statutes and the grassy earthworks and the great body of tradition. But a good deal of the reality has been filtered out. When we look back, we see Washington crossing the Delaware on a cold winter night, or kneeling in prayer in the snow of Valley Forge. We see the Minuteman, or the lanky Virginia rifleman, picturesque in fringed buckskin. But somehow it all seems to be out of a pageant, and neither Washington nor the men who followed him quite come alive for us. This is a pity, because the central reality in this great act that brought a nation to its birth was the living, aspiring, struggling people who were immediately involved in it. A romantic haze has settled down over the whole affair, and when we look through it, the facts tend to be a little blurred. And what is most worth remembering, the thing that so often escapes us, is the fact that, like all of history's great wars, the war of the American Revolution was a hard, wearing, bloody, and tragic business. A struggle to the death that we came very close to losing. It was a struggle, furthermore, that was fought out by people very much like ourselves, which is to say that they were often confused, usually divided in sentiment, and now and then rather badly discouraged about the possible outcome of the tremendous task they had undertaken. It comes as a shock to realize how many Americans in 1775 were actually opposed to independence and a break with King George III. A good many historians believe that no more than a third of the provincials were active patriots, and they estimate that another third were loyalists, with the remaining third uncommitted. To continue with the arithmetic a little farther, it is clear that a good many of the people who believed in independence were not always eager to fight for it. When the war began, the colonies contained around 2.5 million men, women, and children, a population which should have yielded some 700,000 men capable of bearing arms. Yet, in 1780, only 1 year before the crucial battle at Yorktown, the Continental Army and the state militia together contained no more than 1/16th of the country's available manpower. But all of this says nothing more than that the people of the Revolutionary period were extremely human. Enough of them, in the end, were willing to fight and die for what they believed in to make the dream of independence and freedom come true, and we who look back at them owe them a debt whose size is almost beyond our comprehension. They did not have a very easy time of it, and if they got confused and discouraged now and then, it is not to be wondered at. For behind the great struggle with the professional armies of Great Britain was the unending struggle between patriot and loyalist. A civil war, just as real and as bitter as the one which broke in 1861. And although the principal battles were decided along the eastern seaboard, the fighting along the frontiers, along the rim of American civilization was, if anything, even more violent, and it continued in many areas long after the peace treaty with England was signed. Furthermore, although the Revolution was a civil war, it was also, after 1778, something very much like a world war as well. The fighting extended from the West Indies to India, and at times, England itself was in as much danger of invasion as in the year of the Spanish Armada. It sometimes is hard to see how the Americans could have won if the Revolution had not turned into a world war, That is, if France had not intervened in the wake of the surrender of Burgoyne's army. And yet, there was an unconquerable toughness at the core of the American effort. The farmers and shopkeepers of Massachusetts and Pennsylvania and South Carolina and the other colonies were hard men to beat, and they went quite away on their own without any help from anyone but themselves. They knew little about European methods of warfare, and despite all of the tales about frontier riflemen fighting from behind trees, most of the great revolutionary battles were fought according to the European style, and they were poorly equipped, usually ill-fed, and almost constantly badly clothed. But fighting against the world's greatest power, they managed not only to hold off disaster, but usually to give a little better than they got. Somewhere, in the course of more than 6 bitter years of warfare, those Americans worked something out. They began to see, amidst the monotony and discomfort and acute danger and suffering of constant campaigning, that they were somehow more than just the soldiers of the separate colonies. Somewhere, through their efforts, because of their efforts, because of what they learned while they were making the efforts, a nation was born. As South Carolina's Christopher Gadsden had urged before the fighting even started, they began to see that there ought to be no more New England men, no New Yorkers, but all of us Americans. That came, and finally, independence came after it, as it had to come once the vision had truly taken hold. This book is an attempt to give flesh and blood to the war that gave us our independence, to get back to the reality beneath the legend. Not only in words, but also, as far as it is possible, through pictures drawn and painted by men who lived through those times. If it provides a clearer understanding of what was believed and done during the Revolution, if it breathes a little life into the legend of the men who provided us with our freedom, it will have served its purpose. Chapter 1. The World Beyond America. The temper and character which prevail in our colonies are, I am afraid, unalterable by any human art. An Englishman is the unfittest person on earth to argue another Englishman into slavery. Edmund Burke, March 22, 1775. For the farmers in the valleys, hills and plains of America, and the fishermen scattered down its endless coast, Europe, in the 18th century, had little meaning. Few realized that their lives were tangled in a web of forces, diplomatic, social, and economic, that stretched from London to Moscow, or that their fate might be settled on the plains of India or amidst the isles of the Caribbean. But it was so. For nearly a century, Britain had been locked in a struggle with France. On its outcome, the fate of the world depended. And there were more subtle ties than these. When Benjamin Franklin walked the streets of London and Paris, he saw and heard what was familiar to him in Boston or New York. The same lovely proportions of houses and furniture caught his eye. Richer, perhaps, and more ostentatious in decoration, but recognizably similar. He heard voiced the same discontents and the same aspirations. Frenchmen and Britons talked to him of the tyranny of feudal privilege, of the glories of liberty, of the need for equality. He learned how they, too, felt their lives to be thwarted by kings, nobles, and ancient forms. He came to understand the strength of the age-old institutions governing European society. Above all, he came to know that the fate of America was entwined with Europe, and that forces unleashed there would help mold its destiny. When King George III succeeded to the British throne in 1760, the whole nation had become drunk with victory. The previous year, the year of miracles, London church bells had rung out day after day to celebrate fresh triumphs in France. Wolfe had taken Quebec, and French colonies dropped like ripe plums into the hands of marauding English admirals. As the annual register for 1759 recorded of Great Britain, in no one year since she was a nation has she been favored with so many successes, both by sea and by land, and in every quarter of the globe. Trade flourished. Production soared. War, as William Pitt, London's hero, had forecast, brought wealth. Wealth and empire as vast as his own wild dreams. This lean, hawk-eyed statesman, sick in body and mind, felt called by destiny to lead England to greatness. He believed that France had to be reduced to a second-rate power, Spain despoiled. His hero, Frederick of Prussia, could keep the rest of Europe in proper subjection. 2 years later, though Pitt, at odds with his self-willed monarch, had been cast from the ministry, the dream was fulfilled. In America, Canada, the West Indies, Africa, and India, French power had been destroyed. In 1761, the Navy, taking advantage of Spain's belated alliance with France, captured Manila, and the next year, Havana. British ships swept the seas, and the world lay at England's feet. Yet neither the king nor Pitt's successors could bring themselves to accept so fabulous a prize. They feared, perhaps rightly, the jealousy of the defeated powers. And so by the time peace was finally signed at Paris in 1763, with Pitt out of the ministry, England's demands had been reduced. Nevertheless, the gains proved enormous. Canada, Florida, and all lands east of the Mississippi were cleared of Frenchmen and Spaniards. In India and the West Indies, the spoils were nearly as great. All this was sufficient to make the British Empire the greatest the world had known since the fall of Rome, sufficient, too, to arouse that envy and hatred which George III and his advisers feared. If, in the eyes of many American colonists, England was feudal, tyrannical, reactionary, in the eyes of European monarchs, the English were a wild, upstart race, notable for their revolutions and their almost pathological adherence to liberty. A people who kept its kings in subjection and rioted at the least provocation. A nation of hard-drinking, beef-eating shopkeepers with the instincts of pirates. Compared with the rigid European systems of government and law, Britain appeared unstable and anarchic. Yet, no one could deny that she was rich, possessing an exceptionally buoyant financial system, growing trade, and technological superiority. As early as 1721, Montesquieu perceived in England liberty rising ceaselessly from the fires of discord and sedition, a prince constantly trembling on an unshakable throne, a nation which is wise in its very madness and mingles commerce with empire. And these things mattered more than the power of despots. Many contemporaries, however, including Americans, thought otherwise. To them, the great European powers were stronger, richer, more cultured, and more secure than Britain. Absolute monarchies, blessed by God and stable to eternity. And the greatest of these was France, whose language had become the lingua franca of science, diplomacy, and the arts. The Earl of Pembroke insisted that his son must have, cost what it might, the best fencing and dancing masters in Paris. Russian, Swedish, German, Austrian, even Spanish and Italian aristocrats shared his sentiments. The French knew how to live as no one else did. The nobility of Europe spoke French, wore French clothes, sat on French furniture, bought French pictures, collected French porcelain, read French books, and pretended to believe in French philosophy. No one was educated until he had lived in Paris, visited Versailles, and listened to the intellectual gossip of the famous salons. There they imbibed the ideas of Bayle, Condorcet, Diderot, Quesnay, and above all, of Voltaire, the archpriest of the fashionable cult of reason, who set forth the doctrine that we must regard all men as our brothers. These philosophers vaunted man's capacity to control his universe. They insisted that law, government, and religion could only be respected insofar as their principles could be justified on intellectual grounds. They derided tradition, superstition, revelation, and mystery. They talked endlessly of justice, equality, and reason. But the heart, too, needed its prophet and found him in Jean-Jacques Rousseau. This vagabond son of a watchmaker ran counter to almost every movement of his time. He detested privilege, injustice, inequality, and man's brutality to man. Nature was his panacea, the primitive his ideal, all wrapped in a golden haze of sentiment and hope. So duchesses built dairies, installed a cow in a rococo setting, and, to universal applause, milked it into a Sèvres vase. Grottos, Gothic follies, and lonely hermitages became a necessity for a nobleman's park. After a refreshing draught of nature, the salons shone more brightly, the witticisms crackled, and the sharp laughter blotted out the future. Whether or not Louis XV ever said, "Après moi le déluge," the remark summarized perfectly the temper of the times. To the earnest middle class, to men of the stamp of Benjamin Franklin or Thomas Jefferson, the ideas of Voltaire and Rousseau were serious matters. The king was not amused when Caron du Beaumarchais said he owed more livres than there have been minutes since the death of Christ. But neither were the mass of French people. Men who hated the feudal privileges that warped their lives listened to Voltaire and Rousseau and longed for a freer and more just world. The smart, slick talk of Versailles and Fontainebleau became revolutionary fervor in Philadelphia and Boston. Everywhere there was a sense of a new, brighter, more hopeful world struggling to be born. Even monarchs felt it. Frederick the Great, autocrat of Prussia, patronized both Voltaire and Rousseau. So did Catherine of Russia. Both saw the need for efficient government. Both hated the church and its privileges, and both feared the liberating influence of the new philosophy. As with monarchs, so with aristocrats. They were attracted and repelled. These smart, fashionable ideas corrupted their faith in themselves and in the institutions upon which their power was based. Only an eccentric few like Lafayette could swallow the consequences of the new ideas. A world in which all men were free, equal, and brothers. The welcome given to the American War of Independence by the French aristocracy was due to their hatred of England, not their love for equality. France led the world not only in thought, but in all that adorns the life of man. The court of Louis XV, and later that of his grandson Louis XVI, achieved a standard of luxury that Europe had not witnessed since the Augustan emperors. As if to complement the fantastically elaborate etiquette of the court, populated by nobles whose only industry and function is that of dressing gracefully and eating sumptuously, architects, craftsmen, and painters of superlative skill created a world of decadent beauty. The fête champêtre of Fragonard, the luxuriant nudes of Boucher, the soft sentiment of Greuze, and the harsh realism of Chardin dominated European painting. The ébéniste of Paris and Versailles produced masterpieces of cabinet making that render much of the vaunted work of Chippendale and Sheraton heavy and provincial. Nor was such excellence confined merely to Paris and the court. France was alive to its own greatness, alive to the riches which lay in its soil and in the hands of its craftsmen. The government created the finest transport system in Europe, the best roads, the best canals. New ideas and industrial techniques were eagerly sought after and, if need be, stolen. Population, trade, industry grew with each passing year. In science, Buffon, Lavoisier, and Laplace were the masters of Europe, beholding in all this achievement something which awes and commands the imagination. Edmund Burke decided that England was an artificial country. Take away her commerce, and what has she? With such wealth, with such intellectual and artistic supremacy, the future, most Europeans felt, must belong to France, in spite of her recent setbacks in the struggle with Britain for empire. No European country could rival her. Prussia, well disciplined as she was, lacked the proper sinews of a great power: coal, steel, men, and money. Russia lay like a spastic elephant across the threshold of Europe. The Austrian Empire, better governed and more closely knit under the rule of Maria Theresa and her son, Joseph II, seemed greater than she was. Lacking trade, industry, and proper communications, the empire had no future. The fabulous wealth enjoyed by the court derived from the rich but recent conquest of the Turk and was soon dissipated. Geography denied Austria greatness. And if Austria had no future, Italy and Germany had no present. A fantastic conglomeration of principalities, electorates, bishoprics, grand duchies and the like, some well, some badly governed, some homes of enlightenment, some archaic and feudal, all were too small to play any part in Europe's destinies except to provide cheap cannon fodder for the armies of their richer neighbors. Beyond the core of Europe, Spain and Portugal drifted along, sometimes energized by an active statesman, but usually content to follow in the wake of their senior allies. Portugal had tied herself to Britain, Spain to France, by a family compact between their Bourbon rulers, signed in 1761. Nor was there any rival in France to the north. The Dutch, rich and thrifty, lay moribund under an ossified system of federalism which bound their energies in chains, preventing those quick decisions and desperate gambles so necessary for success in a world of armed, competitive states. Scandinavia and Poland lacked force and became mere pawns in the diplomatic game. Their aristocracies grew rich and corrupt on French, English, and Russian gold. France was indisputably master of Europe. Yet, in her fight for empire, France had failed. She had been dismissed from the wide plains of the Mississippi, forced to yield Canada, and beaten in the race for the fabulous riches of India. Few expected France to remain content with humiliations such as these. She retained springboards in the mouth of the St. Lawrence, in the Caribbean, and within India. And the statesmen of Europe feared both her power and the renewal of the contest for empire. The British felt that their 7-year struggle with France, with its huge expenditure of blood and treasure, had saved the 13 colonies from French tyranny. That success placed moral obligations on America. Britain expected that any prospect of a renewed contest with France would strengthen America's sense of dependence on the mother country. Ironically, when that final contest came in the Napoleonic Wars, America was at first neutral, then an ally of France. Yet even so, England prevailed. France proved to be no match for its brash, rich neighbor, a land that could lose an empire and yet remain strong enough to withstand the mighty force of the French Revolution and Napoleon. To American eyes, Britain in the third quarter of the 18th century was a familiar mixture of privilege and liberty, elegance and filth, antiquated habits, and new inventions. New and old were jostled uncomfortably together. Fabulous riches mingled with dire poverty, and the wonders of the age belonged to the few. Placid countryside and sleepy market towns suddenly woke to rick burnings, machine smashings, hunger riots. In a period of 12 months, Benjamin Franklin witnessed riots about corn, riots about elections, riots of colliers, riots of coal heavers, riots of sawyers, riots of Wilkesites, riots of government chairmen, riots of smugglers. The starving poor were run down by the yeomanry, herded into jails, strung up on gibbets, transported to the colonies. No one cared. This was a part of life like the seasons, like the deep drinking, meat-stuffing orgies of good times and bumper harvests. Life was cheap enough. Boys were urged to fight. Dogs baited bulls and bears. Bare-fisted boxers fought the clock around and maimed each other for a few guineas. Sailors and soldiers knew the lash and the savagery of power-drunk officers. Each passing year saw the ferocity of the law grow greater. Death came so easily. A stolen penknife and a boy of 10 was strung up at Norwich. A handkerchief taken by a girl of 14 brought her the noose. Every 6 weeks, London gave itself up to a raucous fate as men and women were dragged to Tyburn to meet their end at the hangman's hands. This rough, savage life has been immortalized by Hogarth, Rowlandson, and Gilray, so much truer to life than the delicate gentility of a Gainsborough or Zoffany. Vile slums in the overcrowded towns bred cruel epidemics, and the treatment of disease was as violent as the sickness itself. Children died like flies. Most men got through two or three wives. Yet, the British were as tough and as callous as they were aggressive. They took these things in stride, as part of life's vast gamble. As Bunker Hill was to show, they knew how to die. Living so close to death, they grew to love risk. Betting provided an outlet. Raindrops running down a window pane, the fertility of a dean's wife, horse races, cricket matches, dog fights, dice and cards, all were fit subjects for a bet. Fortunes vanished overnight. When Lord Stavedale lost £12,000 in a single throw, he thanked God that he was not playing for high stakes. The Duchess of Devonshire ruined her marriage by losing £1 million at cards. The lower classes aped their betters. Cockfighting ruined farmers. Cricket bankrupted yeomen. Pitch and toss emptied the pockets of the laboring poor. And this gambler's attitude to life blinded Englishmen to their own terrible dangers, when the colonists rose in revolt and linked their fortunes with the might of France and Spain. Although life was hard and cruel, often violent, always shadowed by death, it could be full of light and laughter and wonder. Some found an emotional release in religion, in the violent and passionate calls to salvation of John Wesley and George Whitefield. New wealth brought hope to others, for riches, no matter how unevenly distributed, were pouring into Britain, creating new standards of elegance for an ever-widening middle class. Amid turbulence, anarchy, and privilege, there were groups of highly intelligent, strong-minded men and women who possessed faith in man's capacity to order his world. Believers in science, in education, in industry, in invention, in good roads, new canals, sanitation, better laws, pure administration, social discipline, good housing, and higher wages for better work, they were determined to create a richer, more just, more efficient society. They knew that the future belonged to Britain, and their faith was derived from the evidence of their own eyes. To this world, Americans were both strangers and brothers. They too experienced savage, hate-driven mobs. Bad harvests and sudden deaths scarred their lives. They knew the scorn of privilege and the law's ferocity, nor were they unfamiliar with the sweeter side of life, the sustaining strength of religion, the sense of growing prosperity, the touch of elegance which the wider world brought to their towns and seaports. And yet, wherever they looked, they realized their subordination. They were a remote people and, by comparison, poor. The teeming exuberance of British commerce and industry mocked their own puny efforts, and the ringing golden guineas shamed the debased paper currency upon which their economy depended. Envy and hope of emulation stirred the colonist's heart when he thought of Britain. A vast change has taken place in English social life within two generations, wrote Arthur Young. View the navigation, the roads, the harbors, and all other public works. Take notice of the spirit with which manufactures are carried on. Move your eyes, which side you will, you behold nothing but great riches and yet greater resources. What he said was true. Brindley's Canal, constructed in the 1760s for the Duke of Bridgewater, demonstrated the reduction of costs by water transport, widening markets, and cheapening raw materials, coal, iron, wool. Mile upon mile of new roads were being engineered, and along them sped commercial travelers, carrying in their bags miniature samples of furniture, dresses, pottery, and silver to show in every market town. Nothing, however, demonstrated England's wealth so vigorously as her own crowded seaports. London, Liverpool, and Glasgow resounded to the hammer blows of workmen building new docks to house a merchant fleet greater than any the world had ever known. On their quaysides lay the produce of the New World, tall, straight masts from New England forests, barrels of tobacco and molasses from the south, furs from Canada and the far Mississippi, sugar and mahogany from the Caribbean. All the raw materials of England's trade that she carried to the most distant seas. Even Qian Lung, the celestial emperor of China, had heard of this strange face of red-headed barbarians who were foolish enough to barter silver for tea. Wherever they sailed, the British sought profit rather than empire, and great wealth poured back to fertilize the expanding industrial revolution. Across the Atlantic, the American merchant knew only too well how Britain dominated world trade, for he was caught in a tangle of regulations which subordinated his own growing commerce to that of the motherland. Even worse than the regulations was the supremacy of sterling, of which his currency bought so little, and for which his need grew ever greater. Navigation, roads, harbors, a world-dominant currency do not tell the whole story. Change was just as visible in the way of life of the prospering class. In villages, in market towns, above all, in London and in the new fashionable spas, spacious Gregorian houses were being built with a sense of elegant proportion that has given them a preeminence for beauty to this day. They were decorated with exceptional taste, for their architects were familiar with the finest work of Italy and France. Within, plasterwork, marble fireplaces, and gilded paneling displayed the same faultless taste. Furniture, provincial and plain by French standards, reached a level never since excelled by English craftsmen. Silverwork of the highest order adorned the tables of the rich, while the newly invented Sheffield plate enabled the middle class to copy the aristocrats' silver at half the cost. Porcelain and ornamental pottery, both novelties to the nation at large, became manias for all. The well-to-do bought the beautiful productions of Chelsea, Bow, Derby, Worcester, or Wedgworth. The thrifty poor indulged themselves with the crude chimney ornaments of Staffordshire potters. Clothes were as rich, as ornate, and as handsome as the houses and towns in which they were displayed. Balls, plays, and concerts, at which the new compositions of Bach, Haydn, and Mozart could be heard for the first time, took place in a setting as harmonious as the melodies themselves. Sadler's Wells and Islington Spa provided shopkeeper and artisan with all the delights that their superiors enjoyed in greater elegance at Ranelagh or Vauxhall. The aristocracy was richer, far richer than it had ever been. Italy, France, and Germany were ransacked for treasures, pictures, sculpture, tapestries. Private orchestras played to the musical. Zoos entertained the naturalists. Gardens, for which rivers were diverted and the Himalayas pillaged, delighted the botanists. Private laboratories, rare libraries, and hired philosophers nourished the intellectuals. Whatever they desired, they bought. From peer to pauper, there was a gusto about life, a confidence, an ebullience, and a waste that argued a profound belief in their own destiny. Indeed, it bred an overconfidence, leading many to belittle the troubles in America as trifles and to dismiss airily the early defeats. For how could a few ill-armed, ill-disciplined colonists challenge the greatest empire since Rome? Certainly, they felt gauche before French fashions. Admittedly, they respected French art and French literature profoundly. They did not believe themselves educated until they had spent some years on the grand tour in France and Italy. Nevertheless, they knew their government and their church to be the best in the world. The most jealous of liberty, the most conducive to prosperity. Nor were they blind to their own achievements. They worshipped Shakespeare, revered Isaac Newton and John Locke, took pride in Gibbon, Hume, and Blackstone, and delighted in the novels of Fielding, Smollett, and Richardson, and in the plays of Sheridan and Goldsmith. And they were as impressed by the pontifications of Dr. Johnson as by those of any encyclopedist. They were pervaded not so much by a sense of inferiority as by a desire to learn. Yet, the wonders of this new age, its greatness and its hope, belonged to the few, not to the many. War, commerce, and invention. These were the factors primarily responsible for setting the social life of Britain in violent motion and complicating the problems of its empire. Britain had been more or less continuously at war, except for 18 years under Sir Robert Walpole, for more than a century. As a young man, William Pitt, later Earl of Chatham, in a speech of fiery eloquence told the Commons, "When trade is at stake, you must defend it or perish." When he died, the city of London raised a monument to him at the Guildhall, upon which these words of Edmund Burke were inscribed: "A statesman by whom commerce was united with and made to flourish by war." It was true. Marlborough's wars had reaped victory's harvest in the West Indies and the Spanish trade. Clive had wrested Bengal, worth £2 million a year, from the supine hands of the decadent Moguls, and Chatham's genius had won the greatest gains of all. Canada, India, and West Africa had witnessed his conquests and paid for them out of increased trade. Tobacco, sugar, rice, furs, timber, fish, silk, cotton, and tea poured into British ports, a torrent of liquid wealth that fertilized all that it touched. Yet war had won trade, not empire. Chatham himself spurned Clive's offer of Bengal to the nation. He preferred to leave such desperate problems of government to the East India Company. Chatham saw empire in trade, in the possession of ports and strategic points, and in the denial of advantages to France, not in the rule and subjugation of millions of his fellow men. Nothing illustrates this better than his attitude toward Quebec. He regarded its possession as a strategic necessity for these reasons. It would secure the entire trade in fur and fish. The French would be prevented from supplying their West Indian islands with lumber, which would drive up the price of French sugar to the advantage of British sugar merchants. France would lose a market for manufactures. France would no longer be able to build ships in America or acquire masts and timber. And finally, expulsion of the French would give security to British North American colonies. Possession of the vast plains of Canada did not interest Chatham. Trade and wealth monopolized by English-speaking people was his aim, so when the conflict came with America, this great imperialist could sympathize with the colonists' tribulations and bring to their aid his magnificent eloquence. War not only increased trade, but also freed money and multiplied it. Sterling became the hardest currency in the world, creating prosperity for English merchants and bringing hardship to Americans. Between Britain and her colonies, there was an adverse balance of trade that had to be paid in guineas. The debts of planters and merchants grew. The shortage of currency became acute. To prevent wild inflation, the British government forbade paper currency, and the plight of American farmers and artisans grew worse, underlining their subservience and increasing their feeling of resentment toward Britain. In England, cheap money stimulated speculation in new enterprises and inventions which in turn had a profound effect on the Industrial Revolution. Plentiful money created demand for goods, for food, for those small personal luxuries that are the symbols of affluence. And, as is usual in times of prosperity, the population began to grow until, by 1780, Britain was rapidly becoming a nation dominated by youth. The need for labor had long been apparent and, at last, a conscious attempt to alleviate problems of disease and sanitation was made. The shortage of hands stimulated men's ingenuity in other ways. Employers began to provide incentives. Better wages, better housing, facilities for education and religious worship. Industrialists began to pay great attention to methods of production. Division of labor became the slogan of efficiency. The factory system spread, which led to greater discipline and evenly flowing production. At first, workers hated it, and manufacturers were forced to employ women and children, both amenable to regular hours and repetitive tasks. These actions increased production, but never fast enough. All the great entrepreneurs of 18th century England were so preoccupied with invention. Everything, wrote Josiah Wedgwood, yields to experiment. Manufacturers joined the Royal Society. Wedgwood himself contributed a paper on the pyrometer and cultivated scientists. Watt's introduction of the steam engine in 1769 and the development of an improved version with rotary motion in 1781 freed mankind for the first time from the natural sources of power, opening up limitless vistas for industrial society. Joseph Priestley, one of the outstanding men of his day, scientist, philosopher, reformer, numbered dozens of manufacturers among his close friends and admirers. In all manufacturing towns, the spirit of inquiry dominated men's minds. The result was a remarkable spate of inventions. Arkwright's spinning frame, 1769. Hargreaves' jenny, 1770. And Crompton's mule, 1779, revolutionized the production of yarn and turned the spinning wheel into an antique. The demand for iron, stimulated by war, led to the inventions and improvements of smeaton, cort, and craneages. Smelting by coal, invented earlier in the century and kept a jealous secret, spread throughout the industry. The works of Caron in Scotland and Doelais in Wales became the wonders of their age. To show his faith in iron, John Wilkinson, the great iron master, built iron bridges, iron boats, iron chapels, and was buried in an iron coffin. Human ingenuity left no industrial art unimproved. The same vigorous spirit spread throughout England's greatest industry, the land. Improvement in agriculture was already many generations old, but from 1750, the pace of change quickened. Agriculture leaped into fashion. George III was nicknamed Farmer George because of his passion for agriculture. The huge, beef-eating, beer-drinking caricature of all Englishmen, John Bull, was a farmer. More mouths to feed and more money for food brought prosperity to the land and, ironically, strengthened those traditional forces that were most opposed to all change in politics and society, the country gentlemen. A totally different breed were the new men, men who took delight in reform and improvement. Their willingness to experiment, to risk the new against the old, did not stop at industrial organization or agrarian management. The Arkwrights, Strutts, Wilkinsons, Wedgwoods, and Cokes applied the same principles to society. They lost patience with traditional muddle. Old, broken-down roads with puddles the size of ponds in which men and horses floundered and drowned were useless to them. Slums, pullulating with disease, were an affront to their intelligence as well as their humanity. Good houses spelled healthy workers and a better output in the factory or on the land. Paved streets, like good roads, meant lower costs. A plentiful water supply eased industrial problems, provided better sanitation, and improved health. Both social discipline and social opportunity seemed utterly desirable to the great entrepreneurs. Wilkinson, the ironmaster, Wedgwood, the potter, Bolton, the engineer. At Liverpool, men of like mind laid out the first public gardens. At Newcastle-upon-Tyne, they founded literary and philosophical societies. They were active in all societies, reforming the manners and habits of the working classes. These new men lived in the ethos of social reform, and an unquestioning belief in progress was part of the air they breathed. Yet at every turn, they met traditional obstacles. Often they lacked the social or political power to achieve the smallest reform. Like the Americans, these men were hamstrung by privilege and thwarted by tradition. Any body of manufacturers wishing to cut a canal had to solicit, often for years, the country gentlemen in whose hands effective power resided. England was still governed by a remarkable collection of ancient, unreformed institutions, which were the slow accretion of time and as strong as a coral reef. Sometimes these could be circumvented, but only by much effort. Since only a break with the past could give them the future, these new men became ardent apostles of reform. Their leaders, Adam Smith, Jeremy Bentham, Joseph Priestley, and Richard Price, directed their attention to reform on a national as well as local scale. In their work, they had come to appreciate the value of a rational approach. It was easy for them to believe that reason would be equally effective if applied to human institutions. Liberty and equal rights became their watchwords, and democracy their aim. When they read these words of Richard Price, perhaps I do not go too far when I say that next to the introduction of Christianity among mankind, the American Revolution may prove the most important step in the progressive course of human improvement. They did not smile. They agreed. To them, it was a self-evident truth that nations had a right to self-government, that there could be no justice in taxation without representation. America became, for them, a symbol of that liberty for which they thirsted. They, too, needed to break with a past which pressed so heavily upon them. At times, their political impotence bred despair for the future. As one of these new men wrote to his son in the 1770s, "Through the folly and wickedness of the present, you of the rising generation have, indeed, a dark prospect before you. Your best way will be to gather as fast as you can a good stock of the arts and sciences of this country, and if you find the night of despotism and wretchedness overwhelm this hemisphere, follow the course of the sun to that country, America, where freedom has already fixed her standard and is erecting her throne, where the sciences and arts, wealth and power will soon gather round her and assist and strengthen her empire there." This black mood fell time and time again across their spirits. They saw opportunity and the promise of a larger future, but they lacked power. Society still revolved about its old gods, monarchy, established church, nobility, and little oligarchies of reactionaries hogged political power in the countryside and corporate towns. Even Parliament, whose struggle for liberty against the crown had made their ancestors' days heroic, had now become effete, unrepresentative, concerned only with its own privileges and indifferent to freedom and justice. So, naturally, their sympathies swelled to all who cried out against oppression and privilege: dissenters, Catholics, Irishmen, Americans. Powerless, they watched their country's empire break to pieces. They protested. They petitioned. They cursed George III, Lord North, and the Constitution, but without avail, for the traditional forces were still too strong. Harbingers of a new world they might be, but the old still held them in thrall. Here lies a significant contrast to America. The Adamses, Hancocks, Jeffersons, and Washingtons held as much the same attitude toward life as the Prices, Wedgwoods, and Hollises, but their position in American society was both more secure and more powerful. The colonies possessed strong traditional forces. The placeholders of the crown, customs officers, royal governors, and their aides and secretaries, who were rarely ardent for social change. Broadly speaking, however, such men were often transient visitors to America, and those that did root themselves in colonial society were far less powerful than their British counterparts. The great tidal sweep of immigration and expansion constantly sapped and weakened ancient ties and old ways of government in America, whereas in England, they had acquired adamantine strength. There can be no proper comprehension of England's difficulties unless the power of conservative forces in English society is understood. The glorious Revolution of 1688 had been a revolt by the property-owning classes against interference by the crown in their local rights of government or inherited beliefs. Consequently, 18th-century Englishmen had an almost mystical reverence for the word freehold. A freehold was not merely a tenure of land. It could mean a benefice, a commission in the army or navy, the possession of an obsolete office or ancient privilege. To advocate the abolition of such sinecures as the tastership of the king's wines in Dublin smacked of revolution, for these were some man's freehold. Also, the glorious revolution had given to the landed classes and their dependents a chance to batten on the state. Church, army, navy, the plantations, the court, and the administration had become a vast racket that provided relief for needy younger sons or dependent cousins. The Earl of Pembroke bought his son a commission so that he could wear a decent uniform on his grand tour. He did not see his regiment for 4 years, but naturally he drew his pay and rose in rank. Any army or navy list in these years reads like a roll call of the aristocracy. The natural assumption was that ships or regiments were property, property that belonged by divine hereditary right to the ruling classes. All the fat offices of colonial government went the same way, and the same was true of parliamentary representation. Lord Egremont bought the parliamentary borough of Midhurst for £40,000. The Duke of Bedford sold Camelford for £32,000. And, as Chatham said, these little towns that sent representatives to Westminster but could be bought or sold like a parcel of fields were the rotten parts of the Constitution, yet even he would not hear of their destruction. The sanctity of the Constitution, blessed by the glorious Revolution, could not be invaded. At the same time, men witnessed a growing arrogance on Parliament's part, a jealous sensitivity to its privileges. Since it was Parliament's privilege to decide the question of its own membership, John Wilkes, elected for the most populous constituency in the country, Middlesex, was declared, not once, but four times, not to be a member of Parliament because he had crossed his king and been convicted on a trumped-up charge of libel. This brilliant lecher, immortalized in the savage cartoon of Hogarth with its devil leer juxtaposed to the cap of liberty, proved a master of political tactics. He outwitted secretaries of state, infuriated the king, and reduced Parliament to near hysteria so that Chatham could denounce its actions as little better than a mob. And in so doing, he became a symbol to worthier men, the hero of all who loved liberty, as popular in Boston as in Liverpool. Wilkes and liberty was a cry that echoed far beyond Middlesex, and his name is forever entwined with the cause of America in which he so ardently believed. Yet, the struggle of Wilkes showed how tender Parliament was of its rights, a lesson the colonists quickly learned, for though Parliament might be prepared to abolish obnoxious taxes, its right to tax remained sacred and inviolable, even to a Chatham. Many Englishmen, like Silas Neville, who were excluded from the magic circle of government, seized on the little acts of tyranny, the assumptions of privileges, on the minor corruption that was obvious to all, and saw George III as a Stuart tyrant and Parliament as a complacent tool. Instead of to Parliament, Neville and his friends looked to the people of America, who are much more virtuous and understand the nature of liberty better than the body of people here, and have men capable of leading them. But in England, there were two worlds, and for those who ruled, the situation was infinitely more complex, a bewildering world of duty that pressed heavily on privilege and profit. It is time to consider the strong conservative forces that were the heart and sinews of British life. Throughout the changing centuries, Britain had been ruled by the owners of the land. They dominated her counties. They filled Parliament and all the professions. Land ownership meant running a parish, providing constables, church wardens, overseers of the highways and of the poor. Landowners kept order, collected taxes, shared out collective duties, provided for the sick and the destitute. Often they were harsh, yet to their own kith and kin, and to those whose roots in the parish went as deep as their own, they parceled out a rough justice and engendered some human warmth. Most little oligarchies of village rulers were linked by ancient friendships with the great landowners, the nobility and country gentlemen of long standing, Often they were bound by economic ties, by renting of land, or supplying of services or materials to the great house. The real rulers of the county were to be found among the squires and aristocrats and their ecclesiastical dependents. They provided the justices of the peace and officered the militia. Their politics were patriarchal. Their destiny was to govern. A dozen families or so in most counties acquired a certain preeminence through wealth or ability or both. Yet, as the American Revolt progressed, the rights and wrongs of it infused new life even into county politics. Voters became aware of the wider world. They no longer blindly followed traditional loyalties to a family, but approved or rejected candidates according to their political attitudes. Instead of ignoring the voters and contenting themselves with family deals, candidates began to address themselves to their electors, haranguing them on America, on reform, on all major political issues. In county after county, the American War revitalized English political life. Docile voters suddenly became argumentative men. But in the 1760s, parliamentary ancestry was more important than views about America. The families of the Knights of the Shire read like a roll call from Debrett. Cholmondeleys sat for Cheshire, Courtenays for Devon, Lambtons for Durham, Cokes for Norfolk, and the same ancient names were to be found representing the small country towns or seaports. Over the generations, a family had established its patronage over a borough. Such men, like the Knights of the Shire, were self-electing, but neither bribery nor government influence got them into Parliament. The security of tenure bred in them an attitude of such independence that all ministries needed to win the support of the majority of them if they were to survive. It was to these men that the oratory of the parliamentary leaders was directed. Tradition, the Constitution as laid down in 1689, was their watchword, rather than liberty. They believed in monarchy, in the established church, in the subordination of Ireland, and the plantations. Most of them were suspicious of Wilkes, worried by Chatham, angry with America, and content with George III. Although these men provided the background to politics, they did not fill it. There were corrupt boroughs, many belonging to borough patrons who detested George III. They brought in their henchmen. A successful merchant with political leanings could usually pick up a seat if he wanted one. So could lawyers. And some boroughs with tiny electorates, like the city of Bath, spurned patronage and worshipped furious independence. There were boroughs with enormous electorates, open to any demagogue with a purse large enough to provide the gargantuan orgies of beer-drinking and beef-eating that all voters regarded as their rights. Naturally, the Crown controlled many boroughs and found seats for its admirals, generals, civil servants, and court officials. But it would be quite wrong to think, as many Americans did and still do, that George III or his ministers controlled very much of the membership of Parliament. Indeed, it has been shown that royal influence at this time was steadily declining, that George III controlled less in 1780 than he had done in 1760, and that the winners, as might be expected, were either the nouveau riche or the long-established parliamentary families. In 1767, a disturbed Benjamin Franklin had observed that every man in England seems to consider himself as a piece of a sovereign over America, seems to jostle himself into the throne with the king, and talks of our subjects in the colonies. Yet, if Franklin thought Parliament cannot well and wisely make laws suited to the colonies without being properly and truly informed, he might have noted that Parliament itself was wildly unrepresentative. As Dean Tucker wrote in a pamphlet addressed to a fictitious nephew in America, I say not only 2 millions, but 6 millions at least, of inhabitants of Great Britain are still unrepresented in the British Parliament. Yet we raise no commotions. We neither ring the alarm bell nor sound the trumpet, but submit to be taxed without being represented, and taxed too, let me tell you, for your sakes. There spoke the voice of traditional England, content with anomalies, satisfied that government should be in the hands of men of great estate, whose ancestry and education had fitted them to rule, and totally ignorant of that other England, for whom the voice of America was the voice of truth. English society was growing both more complex and more divided. The long struggle with France and the social upheavals of the Industrial Revolution created problems enough, but these were complicated further by the difficulties of colonial government. Natural irritations of long standing festered until they proved mortal. And it was Britain's misfortune that the troubles in her American colonies grew acute during the first years of a young king's reign. His personality and political instability that his accession to the throne created made an already complex situation worse. George III has emerged as the bogeyman of the American Revolution, a fate this sad, tragic king in no way deserves. He came to the throne at an early age, but mentally he was younger still. He had developed late. He could not read until he was 10. He lacked faith in his own abilities and dreaded the burdens which the Almighty had placed on his shoulders. Yet, his sense of duty was as monolithic as his obstinacy. He would rule even though it drove him beyond the borders of sanity to that doubtful world of madness that haunted his existence and finally claimed him. Nothing could deflect him from his sacred trust, and a part of that trust was to pass on to his descendants the powers and privileges of monarchy undiminished. The authority of the crown, the authority of Parliament, these things were immutable. For Americans to challenge them was treasonous. These were the fixed stars of faith in his cloudy firmament. There were others. His grandfather's ministers were cheats and traitors, so men experienced in the arts of government and diplomacy quickly found themselves out of office. The king loathed the war with France as a burden the nation could not afford. He insisted on peace, so the vast victories of Chatham brought the nation small rewards. During the first decade of his reign, the period when the troubles with America went from bad to worse, Britain lacked stable government. Constant changes and squabbling groups of ministers deprived the country of any settled policy. Indeed, politicians were too deeply involved in the struggle for personal power to give their undivided attention to the problems of empire. A young, incompetent king, intriguing cliques of courtiers, hand-to-mouth, and contradictory actions, this is the immediate background of the drift into war with America. Beyond that was a nation divided against itself and, looming on the horizon, the titanic struggle with France, suspended, but not settled. Many of the difficulties between England and America were of long standing. The colonial assemblies had been at loggerheads with royal governors for generations. The Navigation Acts, by which American trade was subordinated to British interests, were as frequently flouted as obeyed. Smuggling was rife, to the detriment of British interests. Troops, which the Americans had provided for the wars against France, had been ill-armed, ill-disciplined, incompetent. The British had borne the burden in men, materials, and money, yet in New England, American prosperity was everywhere evident. "You cannot well imagine," James Murray of Massachusetts wrote in 1760, "what a land of health, plenty and contentment this is among all ranks, vastly improved within the last 10 years. The war on this continent has been equally a blessing to the English subjects and a calamity to the French, especially in the northern colonies." Not so for the British, for whom the war and its peace brought greater burdens. Canada spelled security to America at vast expense to England. The western lands that drew Americans like a magnet merely threatened new Indian wars to the British. Pontiac's rising brought an immediate decision. By royal proclamation, George III closed the lands west of the Alleghenies to immigration, and finally, the British government resolved to make a reality of taxation, which had been for so long a dead letter. For years, publicists had pressed the virtues of a Stamp Act, so difficult to evade, so easy to collect. Although there were some forebodings when the Stamp Act was passed in 1765, few foresaw the uproar which it caused. Benjamin Franklin himself tried to get collectors' jobs for his friends. The British argued again and again that the revenue to be derived from the Act, £60,000 a year, was only a trivial part of the cost of North American defense. They stressed with the same sweet reasonableness the justice of the Royal Proclamation. The Indians would be content with the wide central plains, so costly wars would be avoided. The days of sweet reasonableness, however, were past. There were too many signs of British tyranny. Beyond the Proclamation and the Stamp Act were the suppression of paper currency and the Sugar Act, even if easily avoided, all seeming to be part of a deliberate policy to curtail America's freedom and deny that liberty which was an essential right of mankind. America rioted, and British weakness was immediately apparent. The army was tiny, safe only in its forts, and distance forbade speedy reinforcements. The tumult in America baffled the ministry, frightened the merchants, and encouraged the parliamentary opposition. They placed the blame on Grenville, the minister responsible for taxing America. He possessed an excellent head for figures, no imagination, and extreme conceit. The king disliked him, and he lasted only until 1765. In came another group of Whigs, led by Lord Rockingham, who had vigorously condemned Grenville's foolhardiness in imposing the Stamp Act. They repealed it, but now they were courtiers and king's men, and repeal was not enough for George III. The Americans, he believed, and here most men of authority were with him, needed to be taught a lesson and put in their place. Already, British politicians were disturbed by darker fears. If America successfully asserts its right to reject British taxation, what might not happen in Ireland? Its disgruntled, rebellious people might rise up and open their doors to the French. Throughout the tragic story of Anglo-American conflict, the fear of what Ireland might do exerted its baleful influence, for the specter of a breakup of Great Britain haunted the king's mind, jeopardized his sanity, and increased his resolve never to give in to American demands. Much to his relief, for he had deep forebodings about the wisdom of repealing the Stamp Act, the Rockinghams passed the Declaratory Act in which Britain's inalienable right to tax the colonies was asserted. The repeal of the Stamp Act sent a wave of joy through the colonies, and Chatham said he never had greater satisfaction. There were banquets, festivities, and sermons without end. Fine, flowery sentiments were the order of the day. Let the past, like the falling out of lovers, prove only the renewal of love. But it was the moment for a great statesman. America had displayed her temper and bared her grievances. Nothing irreparable, however, had been done on either side. Difficulties abounded, yet they were difficulties which both sides had lived with for generations. Nothing could have been more propitious at this time than the action of George III in dismissing Rockingham and calling Chatham to lead the nation. Chatham's lofty mind was dominated by high ideals. He reverenced liberty and sympathized with America's tenderness on the subject of taxation. France was so real a danger to him that all rights had to be suspended if the loyalty of America was likely to be jeopardized by their assertion. As he himself said, America must be embraced with the arms of affection. So long as Chatham held the reins of power, there was hope. Yet no sooner were they in his hands than he went mad, hopelessly and completely. The tragedy was darkened by the king's obstinacy. Day after day, month after month, he waited for Chatham's recovery. When it came, it was too late. Not only was Chatham too weak to govern, his ministry was in ruins, and all hopes of reconciliation with America gone. He found the British nation more terribly divided than it had been since the days of the Stuarts. Charles Townshend, a brilliant, unstable politician, had gambled an empire for the sake of popularity. As Chatham's Chancellor of the Exchequer, he knew how deeply the repeal of the Stamp Act had been resented by the country squires as well as by the king. Many Americans, expressing their aversion to internal taxes, such as the Stamp Act, had admitted the validity of Britain's right to impose external taxes. Townshend seized on this bogus distinction to impose duties on glass, lead, paint, paper, and tea. This was the beginning of the end. Riots, boycotts, and savage attacks on governors and customs men gave the Townshend duties a warm reception in the colonies. So great was the outcry, so deep the passions aroused, that the American problem exacerbated political feeling in Britain as well as the colonies. Men linked the problems of liberty raised by Wilkes with the demands for liberty by America. In the suppression of one and denial of the other, they recognized the clear imprint of the king's tyrannical nature. The massive attacks of Junius, that brilliant, anonymous propagandist, like Wilkes, a friend of America, hammered home this theme in unforgettable invective. Never before had a government or a king been subjected to such furious criticism in the press. At the same time, Burke added the majestic voice of his rhetoric to America's cause. "The people of the colonies are descendants of Englishmen. England, sir, is a nation which still, I hope, respects and formerly adored her freedom. The colonists emigrated from you when this part of your character was most predominant, and they took this bias and direction the moment they parted from your hands. They are therefore not only devoted to liberty, but liberty according to English ideas, and on English principles. The temper and character which prevail in our colonies are, I am afraid, unalterable by any human art. We cannot, I fear, falsify the pedigree of this fierce people and persuade them that they are not sprung from a nation in whose veins the blood of freedom circulates." Although everyone realized the folly of Townshend's measures, the ministers who succeeded him were doubtful about repealing them. When at last Lord North rose to preeminence in the ministry, he decided on partial repeal. Nothing more was possible. Public opinion was hardening, with a minority for, but a majority against, America. The king was adamant. The duty on tea must be kept as a symbol of America's subjection. The drift to war could not be stopped. The ostentatious American support of Wilkes and the flouting of the Crown's authority in the Gaspé affair alienated many Englishmen who had scarcely given a thought to American problems before. The boycott of British goods, particularly tea, threatened the livelihood of many English merchants. More and more, sympathy for America was confined to those narrow circles of forward-looking men or to professional politicians in opposition. But it was the Boston Tea Party that finally outraged the massive traditional forces of British society. For a time, George III and Lord North became popular, and the coercive acts were powerfully supported not only in Parliament, but also in the nation at large. It seemed easy enough to teach Americans a final lesson and reduce them to obedience. After all, the colonies hated each other almost as much as they hated the mother country. If they made trouble, they could be crushed one by one. Nor was much resistance expected. Although British troops were few, they were tough, disciplined, well-armed professionals, more than a match for rioters and amateur militiamen. If worse came to worst, the colonists could be starved into subjection. The British Navy ruled the seas. Those few who knew the temper of America and the eager hopes of France raised their voices in vain. Once the moment of anger had passed, and the havoc wreaked by the coercive acts had been made all too painfully apparent, sympathy for America reasserted itself, giving fresh courage to American agents in Britain and sowing fresh doubts in the minds of the ministry and its supporters. Both the sympathy and the doubts redoubled as the vista of war opened. Vast distances, lack of troops, the drain of money, fear of France and Spain, and anxiety about Ireland sapped Lord North's courage and made him falter. George III, however, knew his duty. The Americans must be made to obey, for it was his sacred trust to pass on his empire unchanged and undivided to his heirs. So his policy was simple. Suppress the revolt. Use force. Do not negotiate. North, an adroit politician, fine debater, and skilled administrator, but prey to anxiety, lacked this simplicity of approach. He was a warm-hearted man, naturally timid, deeply loyal, above all, loyal to his king. He hated the war, indeed, he longed to give up a position for which he felt he lacked the abilities. He constantly hoped something would turn up. Victory, a chance of compromise, a change of heart. What he could not do was give all his energy to waging a ruthless war, and his choice of subordinates proved disastrous. Sandwich at the Admiralty and Germain in the War Office marked the nadir of British military competence, as the sick and dying Chatham had long ago forecast. France and Spain seized their opportunity for revenge, for they knew that America was a part of a wider world. So from the height of greatness, Britain plunged to defeat. In the final analysis, that defeat would be due not only to time and space and the difficulties of waging war 3,000 miles away, nor even to the revolutionary valor of the Americans, but to the complexity of British society itself. From defeat would spring unexpected victories. Indeed, out of this tragic combat, both sides gained. In England, the failure of the crown and of aristocratic society was so complete that they never recovered their old powers. Defeat so destroyed their own faith in themselves that the abdication of their power to the middle class, to the new men of the Midlands and the North who had acclaimed America's victories, became merely a matter of time. America acquired freedom. Britain moved toward a less privileged society. Furthermore, for the first time, she was made to realize that empire was more than trade and riches. It was a complex problem of duties as well as rights, and strangely for America, there proved to be no separate destiny, only the leadership of the English-speaking world. Chapter 2. The Eve of Revolt. The revolution was effected before the war commenced. The revolution was in the minds and hearts of the people. The radical change in the principles, opinions, sentiments, and affections of the people was the real American Revolution. John Adams, 1818. On the morning of September 13th, 1759, gray-black clouds rolling down the valley of the St. Lawrence lowered over the Plains of Abraham and the rock citadel of Quebec, high above the river. The fields, once owned by the pilot Abraham Martin, were masked by a gray-yellow blanket of smoke, through which long lines of men in scarlet and white were driving east toward the city. Before them stumbled broken masses of troops in mud-spattered white, heading for the gates of Quebec and fancied safety. Veteran British troops were driving veteran French in utter rout from the fields of Pilot Abraham, while in the rear, the British commander, General James Wolfe, lay dying on the sodden, bushy turf. Through the yawning Port St. Louis rode the French leader, the Marquis de Montcalm. Swaying in the saddle from mortal wounds, his fading senses brought him the echoes of wild cheering as kilted men fell on Canadian militia and French regulars with the broadswords of the Scottish glens. It was a small engagement, probably involving few more than 5,000 men on a side.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.